Let me begin by saying that I hated English when I was an undergraduate. I now make a living writing papers and grants. And I watch the History Channel every night. As for chemistry, it'll become obvious in my opening remarks. Before the term biological science was ever used, humans practiced biology to learn about themselves and the living organisms around them. The knowledge obtained from the myriad of animals, plants, and microorganisms studied is what has allowed these organisms to serve as the sources of our food, the sources of our materials that clothe us and house us, and the sources of medicines that can heal us when we're sick and protect us from becoming sick. As a biologist, I've studied the chemical and physical processes that enable humans and other living organisms to acquire nourishment, grow, reproduce, adapt to change in physical surroundings, and even repair damage. It is this knowledge about living organisms and its use that is the basis for modern plant and animal agriculture, for the practice of modern medical treatment and pharmaceutical discovery, and for microbial fermentation technologies that provide our side with everything from the flavorings for chocolate to the medication production for treatment of disease, for bioplastics to detergents, from biofuels to cheese and other dairy products. I think the question, can you re-establish society without the knowledge that I bring as a biologist? Let me wing it for a little. And do I have a timer?
Yeah, you got about another minute.
That's all I need. Knowledge from biological sciences discipline is critical if we want to create the ability to diagnose health problems and disease that range from bacterial to viral infection, to develop medications from plants where the first medications came from, and antibiotics which came from living organisms. The ability to use genetics to establish robust plant and animal agricultural systems through breeding. Cultivating plants and animals for clothing and shelter from materials. How are we going to create vaccines to protect ourselves, our pets if they survive this apocalypse, and our livestock if they are alive too? Communicating science and applications of this knowledge to future generations. If I can't do it, if I can't get on that boat to do it, we're going to go back to the Stone Age. These capabilities go away if I'm not on that boat. Thank you.
Next up, from English, we have Dr. Szwydky.
So, I have a question for the audience, and I want you to answer it with all honesty. So I don't care if you brought a sign that says, whatever. I want you to answer this question honestly. Raise your hand if you recognize the word that I'm about to say. Frankenstein. Oh yeah. Here we go. What that means for all of you. Actually, put your hands back up if you raise your hand. How many of you have ever read Mary Shelley's novel? Bunch of hands up. Okay, that proves my point too. All right, so why is it that back in 1816, this young teenage girl decided to write a story for a ghost story competition that turned into a novel, and 200 years later, in Arkansas, right, a bunch of 19, 20, 21-year-olds recognize the name or the title of that novel. And the reason is because Mary Shelley, when she wrote that novel, touched on every single topic that you're going to hear discussed today. the foundation of civilization and society. Science is important. History is important. Right, biology and chemistry. We have two sciences, right? To show how extra important it is, right? But what's at the core of all society, of all civilization, is storytelling. Every single society, no matter what language they speak, no matter how technologically advanced they are, all societies emerge from common shared narratives, from stories that explore who we are as individuals, who we are as society, what the problems are with our society, and who we wish to become. What do you think? Yeah. So here's the thing, the other part of it, right? And this will be a narrative, right, today. Mary Shelley's Frankenstein touches on the political issues of her day through revolution, the ethical questions in a secular, you know, space that's not tied necessarily to any one religion. And it also specifically asks us to investigate emerging technologies and what we are to do. What's the ethical thing to do with those technologies? So a humanist, and specifically someone who's well-versed in storytelling and those narratives, is going to be someone who you want around to ask, hey, do we really, really need to save chocolate? Or do we really, really, really need to save our humanity?
Third up at the back, we've got Dr. Adams from chemistry.
So, I think it's important that we understand the historical perspective of the work of Charles Drew, who learned and developed a way to stabilize blood plasma some 70-80 years ago. We're going to talk about the historical significance of Henrietta Lacks and the ability to throw her cells here to lay the groundwork for stem cell research. We would not know about these stories if it were not for the ability to communicate them and find art and find print from an ancient writing standpoint. And while it is absolutely necessary to understand the biological significance of organisms as it relates to our health and our environment, however, none of these are more relevant have a relevance as it relates to understanding what's going on at the smallest level. We are in the middle of an apocalypse, guys. We don't know if we have drinking water. We don't know if the air around us is breathable. The abilities and the skill sets that come from learning chemistry and biochemistry can help us take dirty water and make aquafina. Therefore, I am not going to give you a dramatic rendition. I am not going to talk about the significance of the systems that I study. I can tell you right now, we are in the middle of an apocalypse. Half of us have lost our cell phones. Without the advent and technological advances laid by nanotechnology, which at its fundamental comes from chemistry, how are you going to text your mother and father to tell them you are okay?
Last up tonight, we got Dr. Brogi from history.
That's a hard pass to follow, but we're facing the future, and I guess you don't want to hear about the past. But let me tell you, history is about the future. Disasters are human-made. Humans deprived of memory become disoriented and lost, not knowing where they have been and where they are going. So I could choose the easy route. Cliché or quite fun? That's how they've got to become cliché. How many times have you heard the phrase that those who do not learn from history are doomed to repeat it? Yeah. And yes, on this boat and on what is left of our beloved planet, we would repeat all the mistakes that have plagued the world to date, including the mistakes that eventually destroy the world. So let me elaborate on that cliche. Karl Marx said that history repeats itself, first as tragedy, second as farce. George Bernard Shaw, if history repeats itself and the unexpected always happens, how incapable must man be of learning from experience? Ben Anonymous said, every time history repeats itself, the price goes up. Thought be more realistic and humble, and use Mark Twain instead, who said, history does not repeat itself, but does rhyme. Or Sidney Harris, a famous Chicago columnist, who said, history repeats itself, but in such cunning disguise that we never detect the resemblance until the damage is done. And it's the disguise that you will be equipped to unveil. History gives you the ability to find what is left, which matters enormously, because nothing is built from scratch. You will learn how to frame the questions we need, how to research the few dusty documents left, and above all, make sense of them, because they speak so loud about where we are now and where we should go from here. They will also teach you how to do it, crafting a particular reason argument. How many of you have seen or read the classic The Time Machine? I'm a fan of science fiction. Okay, no raise of hands, but that's, I assume that some of you will have read it. And the protagonist lands with his contraption into the very distant future populated by the hapless Eloids and the brutal warlocks. He asks them, where is your library? He's looking for traces of what happened. How has the world become this way? And he goes to that library, grabs a book, and it crumbles in his hands. And then they offer him this recording from this advanced technology that they had that finally shows him what actually happened. He becomes the connection between the beautiful Eloise and the past. He's their time machine, helping them not to turn the clock back, but to save humanity from itself. Let me go show and tell here. In my office, I have this poster. I don't know if you can see it from distance, but it shows three individuals. First, FDR. This is from a local bar. And it says booze. Second, Winston Churchill, booze. Third, Adolf Hitler, nope. And then it says, since 1989, we do our share. Okay, so booze and smoking. Adolf Hitler had no vice other than being a genocidal maniac. Didn't smoke, didn't drink, and he did not read history. He decided to invade Russia, and he did not ask Napoleon. Perhaps how he had done it. FDR was a history major. Winston Churchill was a historian himself. And FDR did not just do that, as you know. He took us out of a great disaster called the Great Depression. When he was a presidential candidate, since we have so many now, a famous commentator described that he was a pleasant man who, without any important qualifications for the office, would very much like to be president. Well, his qualifications was to be a student of history, and he did help not only save his country, but perhaps even save the world. And he's in good company. Some other of our best leaders actually majored in history, and wouldn't you want them to lead us again? Or be like them. His cousin Theodore Roosevelt was a historian. America global power. Woodrow Wilson took us out of another disaster called World War I. Dwight Eisenhower, who also helped us bring victory in the beaches of Normandy. Richard Nixon, another historian called Henry Kerry Kissinger, he did start nuclear disarmament, and George W. Bush. History made another reconstruction possible through historians like Lee Iacocca.
15 seconds.
And then there are also those who made history fun, like Steve Carell and Conan O'Brien, Sacha Baron Cohen. They're all historians. So remember, yes, remember that the key to our future is in the past. The skills to reveal the mysteries of the human psyche that brought us to this are in history. And above all, as one of the giant historians, E.H. Carr, once said, history is for optimists. Optimist because historians should imagine a way to produce peace, prosperity, and justice for all. Thank you.